The dawn is on.
Let us begin then with our opening song, Your Love is Like a River. Bill, if once we have finished the baptism and we're in the middle of the, while we're changing back into dry clothes, if as the music, once the music is done, if you would go ahead and take up the tithes and offerings while we're changing, that would be very good. And then hopefully by then we'll be out and we'll be able to continue. with our worship. So this morning we have the privilege and honor and a great joy to have three baptisms as part of our worship service this morning. And indeed, it is best when we can have baptism as part of our worship, because in a way, baptism is certainly a sign, a way of worshiping God and recognizing His greatness, and certainly our praise of God and part of our worship is doing just that. So we feel very honored and very happy to be able to have that as part of our worship this morning. Let us pray. Lord God, we come to you this morning. We come for the purpose just of drawing closer to you. We come for the purpose of praising and adoration in your name. We come for the purpose of gaining strength and increasing our knowledge and our experience of your Holy Spirit at work in our lives. We come that we may again affirm and confirm our being part of the body of Christ. To thank you that we are adopted into your family. To thank you for the new additions to your family that will take place today. And so, Lord God, we come with hearts full of joy and gratitude. We come to gain the strength and the joy and the understanding that only worship of you, praise and prayer, hearing, learning more from your word, can indeed give that to us as part of your grace and your Holy Spirit. So we come seeking forgiveness for the times we've gone astray. Forgiveness that comes through the life, death, and resurrection of your Son, Jesus, that by his precious blood we are washed clean. By your Holy Spirit we are made whole. By your acting in us, we become stronger and move forward on our faith journeys. And so as we gather together, we also, in recognizing all of the things you've given to us, certainly the greatest is salvation through your Son, Jesus. So we would pray together the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Okay. As I read the scriptures, if our candidates for baptism would come through this door over here, and preparing your hearts as we read the scriptures. Then Jesus came from Galilee to John at the Jordan to be baptized by him. John would have prevented him, saying, "I need to be baptized by you, and you come to me." But Jesus answered, "Let it be so now, for it is proper for us in this way to fulfill all righteousness." Then John consented, and when Jesus had been baptized, just as he came up from the water, suddenly the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, "This is my Son, the Beloved, with whom I am well pleased." Later on, this was at the time of Pentecost, and it's from the book of Acts. When the people heard Peter's message, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and to the other apostles, "Brothers, what shall we do?" Peter said to them, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, so that your sins may be forgiven." Get this. "And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." So those who welcomed the message were baptized, and that day about 3,000 persons were added. That means added to those who believed and who were following in the way. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and prayers. In Corinthians, Paul said, "Just as a body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in one spirit we were all baptized into the body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we are all made to drink of one spirit." St. Paul said to the Galatians, "In Christ you are all children of God through faith. As many of you as were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is no longer Jew or Greek, no longer slave or free. There is no longer male or female. All of you are one in Christ Jesus." In Matthew, he says, hear these words of Jesus. "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am always with you to the end of the age." Brothers and sisters in Christ, baptism is one of the two ordinances given by Christ to his followers. In baptism through faith, we are made one with Christ. It is actually the symbol of our having been made one with Christ. We are buried with Christ and with him raised from the dead to walk in the new life. The washing of our bodies with water is the outward and visible sign of the cleansing of our inner being through the grace of our Savior Jesus Christ. We are baptized not only with water but also with the Holy Spirit. By the same Spirit, we are baptized into Christ's body, the church, and made members of the whole people of God. In obedience to Christ's command, let us baptize those who have professed their faith in him. First one. It is warm. Just as you want to stay in this warm water.
It's hot.
Huh?
Ow.
It's hot.
To me, it is. I don't adjust the water.
Okay. Take your time. Take your time. Just think of how hot it's going to be if you don't enter this water.
Yeah.
Just take your time. It is warm. I can feel it.
Turn on the cold water.
Make it really gets that cold. Is it backwards?
Nope. They just got the wrong ones on it. At least get you some relief. We can just do it right here so you don't have to be farther out.
This isn't funny. It's making this go really awkward.
Is that helping any? Not much. Is that better?
I'm just trying to find myself as cold.
Okay. Well, as soon as you get up, you'll feel a little bit of cold with the part that's...
I don't understand.
Yeah? Here you go. Now, we're going to work together on this, okay? Now, when you're going to go backwards, you're going to hold your nose so you don't get water up your nose.
Okay.
Joshua Harmke, do you before God and this congregation affirm through this act of baptism and your faith in Christ as your Lord and Savior? And do you promise to follow Christ in word and deed throughout your life?
I do.
Let us pray. Loving God, may your spirit fall upon Joshua and remain with him all the days of his life. May the joy of this moment be his forever. Amen. Upon the declaration of your faith and in obedience to Christ's command, on behalf of this congregation, I baptize you, Joshua Harmke, in the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Ready? Very good, sir.
Yay!
All right. Next. Yes, it is.
Bill, go turn on the pump.
Yeah, see, it's it's so hot I didn't find any fish in here because trout live in cold water and not hot.
I know.
So,
you know what? It might be easier.
Now you know.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
She put her hand.
Rachel Tomorrow. Tomorrow. Well, you'll be tomorrow. You'll be Rachel tomorrow, too, I'm sure. Rachel Tamara, do you before God and his congregation affirm through this act of baptism your faith in Christ as your Lord and Savior? And do you promise to follow Christ in word and deed throughout your life?
I do.
Let us pray. Lord God, may your spirit fall upon Rachel and remain with her all the days of her life. May the joy of this moment be hers forever. Amen. Rachel, upon the declaration of your faith and obedience in Christ's command, on behalf of this congregation, I baptize you, Rachel Tamara, in the name of God, the Father, the Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Hold your nose, too. Okay. Amen. Last but far from least. Just take one step at a time. Mark Tamara, do you believe? Do you before God and his congregation affirm through this act of baptism your faith in Christ as your Lord and Savior? And do you promise to follow Christ in word and deed throughout your life?
I do.
Let us pray. O Lord, our loving God, may your spirit fall upon Mark and remain with him all the days of his life. And may the joy of this moment be his forever. Amen.
Amen.
Upon the declaration of your faith and obedience in Christ's commands, on behalf of this congregation, I baptize you, Mark Tamara. You'll be Mark tomorrow too. Mark Tamara, in the name of God, the Father, the Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Hold your nose.
I knew what she did.
Hold your nose. Just kind of go in and then back.
Oh, excellent.
There you go.
Thank you, thank you.
Yay. We have done as Christ has commanded. As those who have been baptized have confessed their faith and committed themselves to discipleship, let us all renew our baptismal vows as we pray. O gracious God, baptize us afresh with your Spirit. May we know once again the newness of life so abundantly shown to these who have been baptized. Lord God, open our hearts to receive them into our midst, that they may know among us the same Spirit of love that was in Christ, who loved us and gave himself for us. And almighty and everlasting God, we give you humble and hearty thanks for our Savior Jesus Christ, who died for our sins, was buried and was raised. Graciously accept these your servants, that they, coming to you in baptism, may be united with Christ and his church, and receive according to your promise the forgiveness of their sins and the gift of the Holy Spirit. Lord God, grant that they, putting on the Lord Jesus Christ, may receive of his fullness and always abide in him. Keep them strong in faith, steadfast in hope, abounding in love. Bestow upon them the many gifts of your grace, that they may serve you well in your church. Defend them in all trials and temptations, and grant that enduring to the end, they may inherit eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Music, please.
As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the starry crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, sisters, let's go down, let's go down, come on down. Oh, sisters, let's go down, down in the river to pray. As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, brothers, let's go down, let's go down, come on down. Come on, brothers, let's go down, down in the river. As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the starry crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, fathers, let's go down, let's go down, come on down. Oh, fathers, let's go down, down in the river to pray. As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, mothers, let's go down, come on down, don't you want to go down? Come on, mothers, let's go down, down in the river to pray. As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the starry crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, sinners, let's go down, let's go down, come on down. Oh, sinners, let's go down, down in the river to pray. As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown, good Lord, show me the way.
Second one?
That's it. And now let us continue our worship by the bringing of our tithes and offerings.
Father, as we come here this morning and have had the privilege of witnessing baptism of three more of your children, we give you praise and we give you honor and glory. And at this time, we bring forth our offerings so that we may contribute in our way to the spread of your gospel throughout the world and the and Father, what we bring is a portion of what you have given to us. And so we would ask that you bless both the gift and the giver. In Jesus' name, amen. Now we come to that part of our service that is indeed one of the most important parts. That is when we gather as part of the body of Christ to offer prayers. It's a time of communicating more closely with God. It's a time of our hearts being open to what God wants to tell us. By sharing our concerns as well as our praises, we are in fact telling God that we trust Him to carry things out. We believe in so doing that His response, His answer, will be better and more meaningful than anything we might think would be the way for it to turn out. So it's a time, really, of our doing more of putting our lives and the outcomes of our lives into His hands. It speaks to our trust and our faith in Him. He already knows everything we need. He already knows our concerns. But as we give them over to Him, we're telling Him we trust Him with them. And it's only when we give Him something that He can work on it. If we say, no thanks, I'll take care of it myself, we're telling him we don't need him. And he goes, okay, that's your choice. I don't know that he says, okay. He probably sadly says, well, it's your choice. And so by our prayer, we're also saying how much we want our lives to be given to him and for him to act in them. So we have any particular praises and or concerns that we wish to hold up to him.
Praise that I didn't bake like a potato in a car fire this week. And my wiring harness put together in the Subaru.
Oh my goodness.
Yep.
Yeah, we definitely hold praise for that.
And praise for Joe for lending me the van because the truck needs work too.
I wonder why you have the van. Praise for Steve that he is okay because he was hit by a deer. Literally.
His car was hit by a deer.
Yes, his car was hit. His car was hit by a deer. The car lost. The deer kept on going, but it took out the passenger side. Yeah, so, but he's doing good. Other than shaken up, obviously. And then praise that this congregation and this church has not only wed Mark and I, but has now baptized our family.
Dun, dun, dun.
That's right. Yes.
Anybody else?
Continued prayer for Katie and the baby girl that she will be giving birth to in December. And prayer for her significant other, Charles. Just, God needs to just get a hold of Charles and turn him around.
In that light also, I would like to offer prayer, or ask for prayer for a friend of Mark's. Mark has mentioned him before. He is not doing well. He had been doing very well, and he's just been going downhill lately with substance abuse. And
his first name?
Joe. You can just see from the things that he says that he is very, very emotionally distraught. His heart and his head don't know. His elbow from a tree branch.
And okay. Very good.
Continue to keep Tammy in our prayers as she goes through the chemo for the leukemia. And continue keeping Keith, Jim's friend Keith, that has pancreatic cancer. He had been in remission for a little while, and now he is back.
Okay.
No.
Would want to also us hold in prayer a former co-worker of Carol's. Her name is Wanda, who has ovarian cancer. Ooh. And it's, the sound of it is it's somewhat advanced.
My sister is having a bit of a problem. We went to the dentist about a month ago, and the dentist is fantastic. Their office staff leaves a lot to be desired. She should have been back in for surgery about a week ago, and they're still trying to figure out what her doctor needs in order to get her tests run that she needs to have run before she can take the surgery. And right now she is in extreme pain. She's been crying for like a day and a half. And just, you know, that God please help us to expedite the whole process and to relieve her of some of the pain until the process, you know, okay, gets squared away.
Okay. I'd like to offer praise being not only a safe trip to Michigan and back, but actually not only got to reunite or have a reunion with some of my teammates and our coach, but also last couple times I'd gone up, I was not able to see my the fellow that lives in the area that I'd been with in the Army, and I'd lost touch with him, and I didn't know, because he had had some health problems as he died, as he what's going on. And something like 4 months after I'd sent an email, he answered me. And so he's doing well, and I got to visit with him also on that weekend. So it's always good to get together with friends, people who've been meaningful things with you. Okay, anything else? Okay, let's go before the Lord then. Lord God, we come before you today. We come having experienced the joy of sharing in baptism. And as always, we're thankful that you have provided the way that we can become members of your family. We certainly appreciate a number of things of our earthly families. Yet how much we also appreciate the opportunity to be part of your eternal family. We also come, Lord, knowing that not only are you our creator, our provider, our encourager, our comforter, our solid rock that does not change, our giver of grace and mercy. We also have become, you are our healer and our redeemer. That we know that all human efforts that reflect those things are really just humans carrying out part of what you are and what you are about. And not only do we thank you for all of that, we also bring before you concerns. Concerns we have in part because we know the world does not have the answers. Concerns because of the importance of the different people who are in difficult circumstances to other people in their lives. Concerned because our desire is not only that they would be physically healed, but spiritually healed, so that they too could join in being part of your family. And if already part of your family, they would be strengthened, that they would become a witness that would draw others to you. So, Lord God, we pray for Katie. We pray for her being able to reflect upon her situation and make choices that would be, first of all, in keeping with your plan for her life. Secondly, what's good for her baby. And thirdly, that the baby's fathers would have an epiphany. That you would indeed create the miracle of healing and lives turned around in his life. That he would be the kind of father for this little girl that she needs. Indeed, the kind of father that we all need as part of our growing up. So we pray that Charles would, even if it takes it, Lord, have a Damascus Road experience. To be fully confronted by you and by the need for him to turn his life around and walk with you. We pray for Mark's friend, Joe. We know the difficulties, the spiritual crisis that is involved with any kind of addiction, whether it's to substances or behaviors, or some people we know are even addicted to certain relationships. We know the difficulties of being able to overcome that. We pray, Lord, that you would give him peace, that you would give him the opportunity of reflecting upon things and begin making choices that will work according to your plan for him. Pray that you will give him the recognition that we would pray for all people who are involved in addiction, that the only way you beat it is to be done with it, to move away from it, to find healthy ways of dealing with life that don't even come close to any kind of addiction. Pray for Judy. We pray for a resolution as quickly as you see possible of her health problems, of the dental problems. We pray too, as a part of this process, would also touch her spiritually to become closer to you. Lord God, we also know that as a healer, we know that as you look at different people, you know as well as we know, you know better than we know, how much cancer is just a dreaded word, how much it can ravage people's lives. We also know that people survive it, that through a strength of spirit, which results in a strength of will, they're able to heal and survive. So we would ask that for Tammy. We ask that you would keep her close to you, comfort her and strengthen her. We saw a kind of a miracle for Keith, and his cancer seeming to be in remission. Lord God, we would beseech you for that same kind of miracle for him, although we think it would be a long term. I ask too that in part of this process he would grow closer to you. We pray also for Carol's friend Wanda. We know that there are several kinds of healing that's needed in her life. Lord God, we ask you to touch her in all phases, that there will be a healing that will have her life in line with your plan for her, and for the good things about her to bear fruit for you. Lord God, we also know that you watch over us, and that there are times even we're not aware when you have delivered us from potential difficulty. Even as we get peeved at red lights we have to stop at, or things that keep us from getting where we want to be in time, we also know that there are some of those instances of potential difficulty or tragedy for us has been averted. So we know that you watch over us. We know that there are times we're not aware of it. So we praise you for the times we are aware of it, particularly it seems so often with our people here, it seems dealing with cars and being on the road and travel. So we thank you for the safety that you gave to Ryan in what could have been a very difficult situation. We thank you for the safety you gave to Steve and ask that there will be no problems in repairing his vehicle and his being able to continue his efforts for his life to be in order, that he can reach a point where he doesn't just feel he's surviving, that he can reach a point he'll be back to knowing and being able to serve you more directly. Also, thank you for safety on the road to Michigan and back. Indeed, other trips to be taken. We pray your continued travel mercies. We thank you for the opportunity to gather with friends, people who've been meaningful to us in our lives. It affirms and confirms our history, the things that have been important to us, how we've learned and grown and been positively affected by those people, and how we're thankful for having those people in our lives. And we believe that perhaps one or two was a coincidence, yet we believe that those people are in our lives because you've brought them into our lives at the right time in the right way. And we're thankful too when we, as a congregation, can touch people's lives in ways that strengthen their faith, that move them forward in their faith journey, that make it clearer and stronger who you are and what you offer to us in your Holy Spirit. What you offer to us as we walk with you each day. Things that the world cannot give. Things the world doesn't understand until they too have experienced your Holy Spirit. So we're grateful that we could be part of that faith journey for Rachel and Mark and Joshua. And hopefully for all those who come through our doors, that they've experienced your Holy Spirit in their lives and it's made a difference, whether it's just opened their minds and hearts enough to begin seeking and thinking and observing and trying to put it all together in terms of spiritual issues, or to the point where they've actually been able to make the choice to turn their lives around and walk with you. So, Lord, we pray for the future of this building and this property, that ministry can continue to be part of what goes on here, that building your kingdom would be the main part of what goes on, that outreach to the community, preaching and teaching the truth, living out the truth, being willing to share it with all those whose ears are open and hearts are hungry. That what we've been able to do on a small scale here can be magnified many times over. So we ask your guidance in the process of closing things out from our perspective and yet enlarging things from the perspective of what we're to be all about as members of the body of Christ. So we ask your guidance. We trust, Holy Spirit, that you will be part of all that goes on, so that the future here is in accordance, O Lord, with your plans. There may be things, Lord, that we have had on our minds we have not held up to you openly. We now hold them up to you silently, knowing that you will answer those prayers. Your ears is open to those as to those we share in public. As many things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Today we've been privileged to have a baptism of three people.
What was that? Clicking noise.
No, that's
okay. I just want to make sure it wasn't the system. Sorry.
That's me fooling around. How's that?
Not bad.
Good. I like it. Thank you. If you do it, I won't have to. Today we've been privileged and honored to have a baptism. Actually, I've written here of two people, but it's actually three people, which is very cool. It's cool, God, to have more than we thought. But doesn't God do that a lot? I have three people who've been longtime friends and have become recent members of Crossroads Community Church. Therefore, in addition to celebrating additions to the family of God, I thought we might look closer at the history of baptism and what it means for us today. First, let us understand that the baptism we celebrate today would be called the believer's baptism because it takes place only after a person is turned from their way of life that was centered on earthly values to a life that's now centered on who God is and having a relationship with Him rather than a relationship with the temporal ways of the world that really do not work out according to the promise that the world makes. This new direction is assured when a person has embraced Jesus Christ as his or her Lord and Savior and has committed his or her heart to walking with Him every day of their lives. And as St. Paul tells us several times over, that it's at the time of one's making that acknowledgement of Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and the commitment to walk with Him every day that one is at that point adopted into the family of God. A lot of people say we're all God's children, but that's not true. We're all God's creation. Those who have made the commitment that I've just said become adopted into the family of God. So we celebrate, as noted above, that there are now three new members of the family of God, and the baptism is our first act of public witness to that fact. It's an outward symbol of an inward change, and we are about to find out much more than just that. Now, a definition of the word baptism is, a general definition, is a rite of washing with water as a sign of religious purification and consecration. This rite was practiced frequently in the Old Testament. It signified purity or cleansing from sin and devotion to God. Since baptism was first instituted in the Old Testament, many have practiced it as a tradition, yet have not fully understand its significance and meaning. Now, it's interesting that in that symbolic cleansing that the children of Israel did as part of the Old Testament, actually they were also lived a healthier physical life. One reason they thrived so much more than those around them was because they were clean. They were physically clean. In those days, too, you saw a lot more of that, the result of pure living, in how people's lives were in this life. So it served two purposes. Number one, it did make their life better. Number two, it was symbolic of that cleansing. And think of how many of the things that particularly were taught in Leviticus and Deuteronomy. After such and such, wash with water, and in evening you will be clean. So it was ceremonially clean. It was something that they were used to. They understood that. You know, we talk about baptism. We don't have that background in our understanding of our faith unless we've studied the Old Testament, and we realize that. We then find in the New Testament that the significance of baptism is actually seen much more clearly. John the Baptist was sent by God to spread the news of the coming Messiah, that is Jesus Christ. John was directed by God to baptize those who accepted his message. His message was, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is coming. So John's baptism is called a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. Those who were baptized by John acknowledged their sins and professed their faith that through the coming Messiah they would be forgiven. It was, in fact, the first step in recognizing that one's been going in the wrong direction and is now preparing to go in the right direction. In fact, the word repent means to actually turn from going in one direction to start going in the other. Now, how many times people have gone, oh, this is not right, and they turn, but then something pulls them back. And they go, oh, yeah. And they go back to the old ways. One of the struggles that we prayed about for Joe. They keep going back. partly because human beings are creatures of habit. Don't take us out of our comfort zone. Even if this isn't working, I know how to survive until tomorrow. Well, we're talking about survival for eternity. You see the difference in perspective. And so it's hard to get them to turn. Now, repentance means being sorry for what you've done. But if you think of what I just said, it's much more than that. For it then becomes an action of the heart and mind. So some people say, I repented for my sins. Means they feel sorry for it. They tell God, I'm sorry for what I did. But think about it. How many times, I'm not saying God doesn't accept that, how many times will you hear an apology from somebody, but they don't say, therefore I'm going to do things different. And after a while, that apology doesn't mean much. It doesn't hold much water. Yes, they understand that's something that has been hurtful or harmful or difficult or whatever it might have been. And we go, well, why don't you do something about it if you feel that bad about it? So it is feeling sorry. That's the thing that pushes us to go in the other direction. It becomes not just being sorry, it becomes much more than that. It becomes an action of the heart and mind, and sometimes even physically of the feet. Saying, you're doing that, I'm out of here. You know anybody that they say, oh, I'm not going to do that, but you stay right there? As opposed to going, I'm out of here? It's an action of the feet as well. And when you make that turn and you start going, that's when you give God something he can work with to give you the strength that you want. But as long as I stay here and keep looking at it, I don't have the strength that I need. In fact, scriptures say flee from evil. Flee from the devil. You want to stand there and fight the devil? Knock yourself out. Guess who's going to lose? Flee. Then he gives you strength. Then he gives you opportunity. Then he opens up things that you wouldn't have if you stayed there in it. So repentance is, it's a thing, and it's moving and it's going, and that's where you get the strength. So first we learn that a baptism is significant in that it represents the forgiveness and cleansing from sin that comes through the shed blood of Christ and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. However, the purpose of baptism includes much more. Baptism by water identifies a believer with God the Father, the Son, and Holy Spirit. For as we read earlier, Matthew 28:19, therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So when you're baptized, you actually join the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. You're baptized in his name. That means now you're part of him. Water baptism identifies a believer with Christ in his death, burial, and resurrection. Paul said to the Colossians, when you came to Christ, you were circumcised, it's in parentheses, but not by a physical procedure, it's a spiritual procedure, the cutting away of your sinful nature. For you were buried with Christ when you were baptized, and with him you were raised to new life because you trusted the mighty power of God who raised Christ from the dead. Now, between you and me, we may have raised you out of that water, but it's Christ that raises you out of the death, of the spiritual death. Romans 6, Paul says, we were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead to the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. You are actually imitating what Jesus did. And just as you're coming up into new life, his resurrection proved everything that he said. I think it was a T.S. Lewis or C.S. Lewis said either Christ was crazy or he was the Son of God. Well, the resurrection proved he's the Son of God and he wasn't crazy. Water baptism is also an act of obedience for the believer. It should be preceded by repentance, which means change, as we said, as turning from our sin and our selfishness to serve the Lord. It means placing our pride, our paths, and all of our possessions before the Lord. It's giving the control of our lives over to Him. In being washed clean like that, you're saying, I no longer have it, you have it. It's a symbol of being washed clean, and I'm now walking with you. In Acts, Peter said, Peter replied, each of you must turn from your sins and God, be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. Get this, then you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. It isn't until you turn, it isn't until you go, it isn't until you acknowledge Jesus as your Lord and Savior, it isn't until you make the commitment, I am going to live with Him every day. See, now you're fit for the Holy Spirit. Now you've opened. That's why. You've had the Holy Spirit around you all your life. Think about it. But you've gone, nope, no entrance. Now you've given the opportunity. Now you've opened the door. Now you give that interest. And now you can be baptized spiritually. Those who believe what Peter said were baptized and added to the church, about 3,000 in all. Water baptism is a public testimony, the outward confession of an inward experience. In baptism, we stand before witnesses confessing our identification with the Lord. Water baptism is also a picture representing profound spiritual truth. Regarding death, baptism says, I've been crucified with Christ, I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave Himself for me. It was what Paul said to the Galatians. Spiritual truth regarding resurrection. We were therefore buried with Him through baptism into death in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead to the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. If we've been united with Him like this in His death, we will certainly also be united with Him in His resurrection. So it says this is what's going on. And you have said, I've shared that experience of death, now it's my life with Him. That's what being born again is all about. It's a new life. It's a new life. Also, in Romans 6, Paul said, He died once to defeat sin. Now He lives for the glory of God. So you should consider yourselves dead to sin and able to live for the glory of God through Christ Jesus. Do not let sin control the way you live. Do not give in to its lustful desires. Do not let any part of your body become a tool of wickedness to be used for sinning. If you think about it, every part of your body could in one way or another be used as a tool of wickedness if you're not aware of it. Instead, give yourselves completely to God since you've been given new life. Use your whole body as a tool to do what is right for the glory of God. Now, it doesn't say that we won't sin. It says don't let sin control your life. Don't let our lustful desires just mean I just want something. I just got to have it. I perseverate on it. I focus on it. I'm obsessed with it. I need this. And I start directing everything in my life in order to get it. And all of us at one time or another have something in our life we've done that with. That's a lustful desire. Some people think it deals with sexuality. It's much more than that. Certainly people get tied up with that, with their sexuality. But there's much more than that. So just don't let it control you. That's what you're saying now. Sin is not in control of my life. I may do it, but it doesn't control me. Because I recognize it. I see it. I turn from it. I ask forgiveness. I repent. I go in the other direction. And God gives me the strength. See, we can learn from that too. Wow, that's a trigger for me. So next time I even get close to that, I'm walking away. I don't need that. God will bring other things into my life if I allow Him that take me away from that, that are more fulfilling than that. We've all had things in our life we thought, that's the greatest thing since sliced bread. Now we look at it, we go, that was dumb. So God helps us find other things that are more meaningful and more important. Also, the spiritual truth in cleansing. This water symbolizes baptism that now saves you also, not the removal of dirt from the body, but the pledge of a good conscience towards God. In other words, it doesn't remove the dirt from your body. It removes the dirt from your spirit. It's a symbol of that happening. It saves you by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. But you were washed. You were sanctified. You were justified in the name of Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. I would also note that although you may be giving up the ways of the world and the desires that go with it, once you have committed the plan God has for your life, you are free from the bondage of the world. In pursuing a life led for God, you find pleasure, satisfaction, peace, courage, strength, and joy that the worldly pleasures and worldly successes can never bring. So you're giving up one thing that only satisfies temporarily for something that satisfies forever. Think of how many times if somebody would have said, well, do you want to spend $1,000 on this? And you'll be happy as a clam for 6 months. But you can spend $1,000 on this over here and be happy as a clam for 10 years. Wouldn't you go, that's a no-brainer? It would be like, why would I go for something like that? This is that same kind of thing. You're exchanging the right now stuff of the world for something that's eternal. And actually, when you turn and you walk with God, you say, I'm no longer going to deal with that. You even find more pleasures and more satisfactions in this life, much less the life to come. Indeed, it's a practical as well as a spiritual experience, for it affects you daily in what you do and what you say. Now, I'll guarantee you that when you make the decision to give your life to God for His plan and not yours, you will find yourself making better choices. Ta-da! It's not just logic of the world, it's logic spiritually, it's God's logic. So you're going to make better choices. You will find your life is fuller and more satisfying. You will find your basic needs are met and then some. You will find that in time you will want to share this with others so they too can join you on the faith journey that ends at the gates of heaven. Thus, there's much more to celebrate today. A celebration is an act of lives changing and salvation provided. A celebration reminds those who've been baptized of the importance of it in their lives, as well as in the lives of Rachel, Mark, and Joshua. And it reminds those who've not yet made that choice that they can make it at any time. Now, all of you have been here many times before, yet I'll say, if you haven't made that yet, and yet today if you desire to make that choice, you can see me after the Holy Spirit if you are so moved by see me after worship if you're so moved by the Holy Spirit. Let us be encouraged by God's never-ending love, grace, justice, and mercy. Let us be encouraged by His forgiveness that is always available because the sacrifice Jesus made and the teaching He gave us are for everyone, and by His word and guidance and the Holy Spirit that are always present for us. Let us pray. O Lord our God, how much we thank you for your never-ending grace and love, for your patience with us all as we can be so slow to open our hearts and minds to you, even though you're always present for us. And we thank you for your love being so great that all sins can be forgiven, no matter how serious or how many there might be in our lives. Lord God, be with us not only as we celebrate the addition of Mark, Rachel, and Joshua into your family, which is also our family. Also be with us to guide us and direct us as we open our hearts and minds to your ways, your calling, and your Holy Spirit. As we ask in Jesus' name, amen. Any thoughts, criticisms, questions, insights? Okay, then we will. Actually, there are two songs. Did we do the one where He leads me, I will follow? We didn't do that, did we?
Yeah, that's the important one. That's the one you're doing.
Okay. Then let's have that as our final hymn.
Which one?
Where He leads me, I will follow.
Okay.
By Willie Nelson. Willie Nelson.
Are we doing it now?
Yes.
Okay, sorry.
I can hear my Savior calling. I can hear my Savior calling. I can hear my Savior calling. Take thy cross and follow, follow me. Where he leads me, I